Hello, and welcome to the inaugural Blesmer Remembrance 11K. Whether you're completing the 11K today or just tuning in to watch the live stream, thank you so much for joining me and Blesmer on this Remembrance Sunday. I'm Sean Rose, and it's a privilege to be your host. Remembrance Day is an important time to pause and reflect on the sacrifices of those that have served. And although COVID-19 means we cannot maybe gather to commemorate in our usual way, we will still remember them. Today's event will see participants from around the country take on 11 kilometres in a variety of ways to help support injured veterans. But more importantly, it's a way we can feel connected with the wider military community on this poignant day. Wherever we are, we know our members, veterans, their families, and the nation will pause and reflect at 11 a.m. to remember and honor those we have lost this Remembrance Sunday. For the next 2.5 hours, you'll be hearing from our amazing 11K participants from across the regions. We'll be sharing with you the incredible stories of our fellow Blesmer members. For those who don't know, I served in the Royal Air Force for 10 years before I was injured on duty in a skiing accident, which caused spinal cord damage. 25th of February, 2000. My life changed when they told me I'd spend the rest of my life in a wheelchair. It was a beautiful day in Germany, in Bavaria. I was skiing with a group of pilots. I was teaching them to ski. I was skiing on a piste I'd skied 1,000 times. I came over the brow of a hill and I hit some wet snow and I was thrown over the front of my skis. And I went in head first like a javelin into the snow. The weight of my legs came through, crushed a vertebrae in my back, and I instantly knew by looking down. Was a lifetime of sport as I knew it? Was it gone forever? Following my accident, I had 3 burning questions. Would I play sport again, and in what form? Would I ride a motorbike again? I love motorbikes, I've been passionate about them all my life. And would I be a real man again? I set myself the goal to improve every day and become world champion in the sport I love. strongly believe if your dreams don't scare you, they're not big enough. And if you have a passion in life, then anything is possible.
John Rose sliding through the finish line. Oh, man.
Passion drives me every day to achieve the unachievable.
People look when they first see me first time and just say, "No, God, that's a massive forehead." But I wonder how he ended up in that. So I'll get straight to the point.
Now I use my experience to help others never stop achieving.
I set myself some goals and they were quite big ones. I just said one day, I said, "You know what, I want to be the best water skier and the best skier in the world." I went, "That's ridiculous. How can you..." So that just, it's insurmountable to just think about. And I thought, right, well, what do I do? I'll break it down. Like any company as well, I'll break it down into manageable chunks. I'll take it to year steps. And then from that year goals and steps, that's where I want to be. How am I going to get there? I'm going to break it into monthly steps. And then that into weekly. And then into what I want to achieve by tomorrow. And then by the time I got to that point, I had something to do today. So that's something to do today. Let me achieve what I wanted to do tomorrow. It let me achieve my weekly, my monthly, my yearly goals. And then it was more manageable, and then it was more understandable. I thought, yeah, I've got something to do today to reach that goal.
If you're passionate about something in life, make it happen. And thirdly,
double Paralympian and proud dad and husband, I want to share how I made my dreams happen. I'm sure there's a diverse range of reasons for you all taking part today, but now we're going to hand over to Chelmsford, where we join Blesma Chief Executive John Bryant, who is preparing for the race.
Thank you so much, Sean. I'm here today with John. So, John, can you tell us a little bit about this very special event and how it all came about?
So, what we wanted to do is we wanted to commemorate. And the idea came about that with COVID restrictions, we wouldn't be able to commemorate as normal. We may or may not be able to attend parades at 11 o'clock. This was months ago. And so we developed the idea of doing Blesma's first blended event. Fellowship, as you know, is vitally important to us, and we wanted to come together as an association. And of course, we've all got much better at being online since March. So we thought we'd combine being online with coming together and to actually physically do something. And the idea of a run came up, and the idea of a blended run came up, and it just developed from there, really. And as the COVID situation has unfolded, we've been able to adjust and make corrections, so we're able to do this. And there's just under 200 people taking part in the event, which is fantastic. And we'll all be doing something together on Remembrance Day. And the aim was always to get our bit done in time so people could commemorate at 11 o'clock as they normally would do.
Fantastic. So obviously the COVID-19 situation has put paid to so many plans and national events this year. Why, in your opinion, is it so important that we still find ways to commemorate Remembrance Sunday?
Well, Remembrance Sunday is very, very important. It's important to the nation, and as a veterans association, it's very important to veterans, of course. Amongst all the pomp and ceremony and the parades and the wreath laying and the uniforms and the polishing that we all remember so well, there are also very poignant memories for all of us and our families. You know, the vast majority of veterans have lost people close to them. And each of us has a moment within remembrance to remember those they've individually lost. So it's a sort of combination of doing something as a nation and doing something very personal and very private individually. And it may happen at some time, at any time during today, but I can absolutely guarantee you it will happen.
Very true. So, John, we've, like you said, got just under 200 people taking part in this fantastic event. Is there anything you'd like to say to them?
Well, it's fantastic, isn't it? I mean, I understand that 10 people joined us yesterday. And we've got people who've already done their Remembrance 11K run by running 300 miles on a running machine. So I've got two messages, really. The first one is to say a huge thank you to you guys and everybody who's put so much effort into making this event, getting it off the ground, both from the team at home, from the families, from the veterans who are running, and also all our supporters. And the second one really is just good luck, everybody. Go out and enjoy it.
Absolutely. Well, thank you ever so
much. Great stuff. Thank you. Genoa Blesma is a tri-service charity which works in collaboration with a wider military community. So we have a special message of support right now from Air Commodore Scott Miller, the RAF Force Protection Force Commander.
The very best of luck to all those competing in the Blesma Remembrance Day virtual 11-kilometre race. This is a hugely significant event to not only mark our National Day of Remembrance, but also raise funds for our veterans who've lost limbs. You're an inspiration to us all. Good running, good luck, per audio.
Hi, my name is Janet Riddell. I served 18 and a half years in the Royal Navy and left in 2008 as a petty officer. I was medically discharged due to an unfortunate incident in Iraq whereby I was in a helicopter that was shot down over Baghdad, over Sadr City, and this resulted in serious injuries to my knee. I had numerous operations but finally succumbed to my injuries in 2017 whereby I had to have a through knee amputation. I was very scared at the time, but Blesma reassured me that they would be there thick through thick and thin, and they certainly were. I became a member of Blesma in 2016, and they helped me through my recovery both mentally and physically. I have made some wonderful friends on some of the activities that I've been fortunate to go on, and I can't thank them enough, I really can't. Without them, I wouldn't be here today. I'm now a volunteer for Blesma and I get so much inspiration from helping others as they helped me. Remembrance Sunday is usually a time where I sit and remember the dead and those who have fallen, and I pay thanks to them and also for those that have been injured and are still serving today. Without them we wouldn't be where we are today, and it's vitally important that this carries on. I would like to say a big thank you to those doing the 11K. For Blesma, and I hope you raise lots of money, but more than that, I hope you get something from this. Good luck and take care during these uncertain times. Thank you.
Hello guys, just want to say a big shout out and a thank you to everyone taking a part in the Blesma 11k run for Remembrance, which is an amazing course and really, really awesome thing to do. Myself, I've been a member of Blesma since 2011. I got blown up out in Afghanistan, resulting in the loss of my right leg. Been a part of the charity ever since. We've got an amazing charity. They've done amazing things. They've supported me over the years with my snowboarding career. And I'm, as you see, currently out in the mountains at the moment. Feeling very lucky to be out in the mountains during this COVID lockdown period. Great work from Blesma and great work for all the guys joining in the 11K run. Good luck, and we'll remember them.
Good morning, everybody. Brian Phillips here. Back in 2005, I joined the Army, serving with the 1st Battalion Irish Guards, doing tours of Iraq and Afghanistan. In 2012, on the second tour of duty of Afghanistan, I stood on an improvised explosive device, losing both my legs above the knee. From that day, I've been now supported by a charity called Blesma, along with other charities of course, but this charity this year has decided to host a virtual Remembrance K 11K run/walk. I'm currently taking part in it at the minute. My intentions were to get up at 6:15, head down to a local running track and just do laps of that until I reached 11k. Had a bad night's sleep last night, so I just decided to get up a bit early, 5:15. I'm now currently just walking around the front garden. What I've realised, just walking around, it is time to reflect. And remember those who paid the ultimate sacrifice? We're lucky, I'm lucky I'm here every day with my kids and I can enjoy life. But there's those less fortunate than ourselves who didn't come home, their families, who didn't see their loved ones come back. So this is my way, and this is the charity's way of paying our respects. I'm doing it today, it's supposed to be on Sunday, but I'm doing it today as tomorrow I have a great team of 11 volunteers who have kindly decided to sign up for the remembrance event. So tomorrow I'm busy admin for those guys, just making sure they have a hot brew when they get back and so on. So to those guys, thanks for signing up and thanks for supporting the charity. It's also, if you aren't at Navin tomorrow, guys, due to limited parades, get out for a wee walk. It's a great way to reflect and remember those who paid the ultimate sacrifice. Thanks guys, have a great day.
And now we turn to another person who has seen firsthand the important work that Blesmer do.
We landed on the night of D-Day, so it was very dark. And I can only remember landing on the beach, and then we moved on through the lanes. My name is Roy Hayward. I'm aged 94, and I lost both my legs below the knee soon after landing on D-Day. A shell hit us and exploded inside the tank. When I crawled down the lane and turned over onto my back, I realised that my right leg was shattered below the knee, and that my left foot had been blown off, leaving me with just a part of the heel, which I think enabled me to stand enough to get out of the tank. I was so numb at the time that I wasn't aware of pain. I was just feeling extremely upset about the fact that I saw what had happened to me. I was contacted by Blesmer, who asked if they could do anything for me. And from then on, that was my, you know, sort of reassurance that I had somebody to look to whenever necessary. I can manage my home and do the shopping and the banking. Blesmer now are concentrating on keeping people in their houses, and that's what I would want to do more than anything else. I would really want to stay where I am, and if it's necessary, I would approach Blesmer to see what if they could help me to do that.
Now, just like John, I know runners are preparing for this event all around the country. So now we're going to have a short warm-up from Nikki, who joins us. Now get yourself ready and let's join in for this warm-up.
Morning guys, my name's Nikki. I'm gonna get you ready for your 11K run today. I'm gonna get you nice and warm, gonna get you nice and mobile. So all you need today is a little bit of space just so you can move about, and we'll start nice and gently, wake you all up, and then we'll get you nice and warm at the end. Okay, so the first thing we're gonna do, we're just gonna do some gentle twists, just warming up that lower back, just side to side. It's quite early, so we're gonna start nice and slow. Okay, and then we're going to change it side to side, reach all the way up, get stretched all the way through that midsection. Okay, just a few more of these. Okay, we're going to take your arms out. We're going to go opposite arm, opposite hand to opposite toe. So stretch all the way down. Just warming up all that waist, your back, your core area. Nice and steady. Okay, just a few more of these. Just twist nice and slowly. Loosen everything up. Okay, and we're going to do two more of those. Okay, so over to the legs. We're just going to start with a nice deep squat. So all the way down, guys. Warming up those quads. Ready for your run. So push up through your heels. Squeeze your glutes to the top. Nice and slow. And go down. Turn sideways so you can see. We're just going to pull down into an inch round. I'm going to work on the core area a little bit. So straight legs, we're going to crawl down. And I just want you to hold a high plank just for a few seconds to get a little bit of warmth through that core area. Bend your knees and then curl slowly to the top. And just give your shoulders a little roll. And again, we're just going to crawl down. Hold that plank just for a few seconds. Bend the knees. Nice, slow curl up, roll the shoulders. So we've got five more. Hold. Warm up, that's cool. Roll at the top. Okay. Hold on. Little hold. Switch that core on. Bend your knees. And roll. Okay, so we've got one more. One more inch round, all the way down. Little hold at the bottom. Bend your knees. Okay, we're just going to do a little bit of work on your hamstrings. So what we're going to do, narrow feet this time, we're going to squat down. We're going to extend the legs, push the heels to the floor. Curl all the way up. And again, squat down nice and low. Extend those legs. Should be feeling your hamstrings warming up now. Roll the shoulders at the top. And again, all the way down. Extend the legs. And curl up. One more. Bend down, extend the legs, and curl all the way up. So we're going to do a little bit of work on your hips next. Okay, so we're going to crawl down again once more into that high plank. We're going to drop the left foot to the left hand, and we're just going to drop those hips, open them up, get a nice stretch through your hip. At the same time, we're going to just warm up the rest of the fingers. So we're going to rotate round, and then back to the high plank. Into your high plank, drop that hip, rotate all the way around, back to the centre, okay. And again, drop that hip, rotate round, so you're back in your core, should be feeling a little bit warmer now too, and your hips, all the way up, and down, okay, one more on the right hand side, and drop your hips, and around. I'm back. Okay, so we're going to just mobilize your ankles a little bit. So we're going to go into a nice deep squat, elbows into your knees, and we're just going to do a little rock side to side, opening up the hips. If you struggle with that, just put your hands to the floor. Just getting some movement through your ankles. You're going to use a lot during your run. Okay, and two more. So let's just step it up a little bit, getting heart rate up a little bit. So we're going to keep our heel squat bombs, arms in, and squeeze your shoulder blades. Okay, warm up the hamstrings. Keeping all the way up. Okay, two more, and then we're going to take it into a little jog, just a light jog. Jogging in the squat. Warm it up, getting nice and warm. Should be feeling it. Okay, so we're going to do four jogs and then we're going to open the hips. So one, two, three, four, and then all the way around. And again, one, two, four. Okay, and just a few more. And one more on the other side. Okay, keep jogging the squat, guys. So good luck with your run today. Have a great run, and Abby's just going to have a little chat to you, and have a great run.
Thank you, Nikki. Good Good morning, everyone. My name's Abby Louise, and I work for Blesmer in the community and events team, and I'll be giving you this morning's race briefing. I hope you're all well and looking forward to taking part in the Remembrance Day 11K. We've been overwhelmed by the amount of people who have signed up and taken part in today's event. There are a few things I'd like to remind everyone before the start of the 11K. Firstly, I'd like to remind everyone to follow your local government guidelines regarding social distancing and exercising in groups of no more than two people. Please ensure you stay alert of others, whether that be pedestrians, dogs, or cyclists on your chosen route. We are sure some of you may be running on a mixture of pavements, paths, and parks. Please make sure you are wearing the appropriate footwear and clothing. And if you must cross a road, please do so in a safe manner. Do not put yourself at risk and do take care of the people you live in. And finally, stay safe, have fun, and thank you for supporting Blesmer's Remembrance Day 11K.
Hello, good morning. Rob Copsey here, Blesmer member, running for Blesmer today on the 11K run for remembrance and for spreading the word of Blesmer. Excuse my sweaty face. As you can see, I'm running on the white cliffs of Dover. A beautiful place to run, and also lots of places to get remembrance. So the reason I'm running for Blesmer, I'm a Blesmer member for 26 years. Blesmer have been fantastic to me. From day one, they helped me with my rehabilitation recovery in body and in mind. And the best thing about Blesmer is Blesmer members helping Blesmer members, backed up by an association of staff who do amazing work behind the scenes, making rehabilitation and welfare matters happen for the members. The members consist of just under 3,000 men and women who have served in Majesty's Armed Forces. They've done a lot for me and many deep people, those who know me, and friends and family. Best charity for the armed forces injured. They do amazing work. I'd just like to thank Blesmer HQ and their staff, all the welfare officers for the work they do. But all because of the COVID pandemic. And I'd just like to say my deep condolences to those families who've been affected by COVID and those who've lost loved ones by it. So they're also in my thoughts today. I wear my poppy for remembrance and my veterans badge. And actually, you can see behind me now the memorial there. And this is unusual. I often not normally celebrate the army. I'm an ex-sapper, I'm an ex-Royal Engineer. But today, I'm up on the cliffs of Dover, and this is the memorial to the Royal Navy and also to the merchant seamen who gave their lives in the channel, which is behind me. And as you'll see, as I pan round, you'll see the English Channel out there, and it's a glorious sunny day today. And back to the memorial. So it's all about remembering those who gave their best and gave their lives for a fantastic, fantastic service they gave. I'm going to carry on running now. I'll try and talk as I'm going. I need to get on with my 11K. So I hope
good morning, Blesmer community, and welcome to the charity run this Sunday. Welcome to the shores of Caicfergus on the corner of Belfast Lock, Northern Ireland. I'd just like to put an extended welcome out to the Blesmer organisers, to the participants, and especially all those people who have sponsored this event, my friends and family included, work colleagues and associates, for without them I wouldn't have been able to complete this event and achieved 300% over my target. Carrickfergus this morning, as you can tell. Looking at the harbour and the castle is absolutely dire. Wind and rain, but that didn't stop the participants taking part. I've just finished my lovely 11k run. Finish line's there, and the boys have a cup of tea waiting for me. I'd just like to say that as an ex-service member of the Irish Guard, amputation has affected my regiment, my company, my platoon, my battalion, friends from different regiments as well. And it's a very worthy organisation. Not only do they help with those people directly affected from amputations, but also their friends and family to help them adjust. And there's a lot, a lifelong, continual adjustment to be done. So I couldn't be happier to be invited to run this and raise funds for it. I'd just like to say thank you again. All those people who I know who will benefit from these funds, keep in touch. If I can help in any way, I'd be happy to. And once again, thank you to all my friends and family, colleagues, and everybody who's helped me raise funds for this. Have a beautiful day, folks. Peace out.
We'll cut to John and Boston in Chelmsford, leaving and starting their 11k. Good luck, guys.
Okay. See you later.
Good luck.
Good luck.
See you
later. Take care.
Bye.
And they should be back in time for the 2 minute silence at 11 a.m.
Thanks very much, Chris, and thank you to Tribal Tracks. Now we will catch up with Jessica Bomber, a Blesmer supporter running in memory of her grandfather. Hi there, Jessica. How are you?
Hi
and,
there.
Where are you calling from and how's things?
I'm in Northern Ireland in a town called Bangor, not far from Belfast. And it's good here. It's a nice day today.
Beautiful. But looking forward to a bigger event coming up now. I've heard a little bit about your story and about someone in particular. But I'll let you tell us. Why did you get involved in the Blesmer Remembrance 11K event?
For me, really, it was because of my granddad. He was 100 last year, and wow. he fought in the Second World War, and he actually lost a leg there. So for me, it's all about trying to give something back, and to remember him as well, and have a bit of fun at the same time, because he always chatted about making memories. So things like this are about making memories, not just for me, but for the rest of the family and for other people as well.
Well, that's incredible. I mean, he sounds an amazing man. Just tell us a little bit more about him. He died at the age of 100 on Christmas Day.
Yeah.
Last year?
Yeah, so last year.
What was he like?
He was such a character. You know, he always had a story to tell. He always wanted to chat to people. You know, nothing ever bothered him. You know, when you compare him to, you know, life today and the things that we complain about, nothing ever bothered Granddad. You know, we would have the odd moan about things, but he just kept going. You know, everything he took in his stride, always had a funny story to tell and always made time for everybody.
Wow. So he joined the Royal Berkshire Brigade, I believe, and it was 1942, World War II. You know, how when he come back and more modern day, how do you as a family, or how did he commemorate this special Remembrance Day?
Well, whenever he was living in his hometown, he was brought up and lived in Herne Bay. Him and my grandmother lived in the same house for, I think it must have been nearly 60 years. They were in the same house, and obviously Dad was born into that house, and I was actually born over there as well. So whenever I first came out of hospital, I was taken back to the same house. But Grandad had a flagpole in the garden. So every time we came to visit, or there was a special occasion or for remembrance, he always put the flag up in his back garden. And if somebody passed away, or if there was something happened, even in the world events, you know, if it was something negative, he always had the flag then at half mast. So, you know, it was such a big part of his life, and it meant so, so much to him. And, you know, a lot of it wasn't good memories, but at the same time, you know, he was very, very dedicated to what he did, and he just took it in his stride.
And you mentioned the flag and his routine of remembering and commemorating, you know, visitors or those that we've lost. But that flag, is it hold quite solid memories now for someone in particular?
Yes, my eldest son, he's 14. And whenever Grandad was still living over there, and actually even for me as a child, you know, it would have been the same for me. Whenever we went to visit, the routine of being able to lower and raise the flag every day was such a big thing. You know, it meant so much. And I think, you know, it's very hard to ever understand what life would have been like then, you know. And my generation, and even my son's generation, we don't have any idea. You know, we hear the stories, and even, you know, my father was a military man, and life in the military then was nothing like what it was for Grandad. So you don't have that knowledge, but to have something that you can share that means something so important. So whenever Grandad passed away, we still have the flag. So that has been passed on to my son. So he still has that and keeps it in his bedroom. And I think it's something that he'll always remember. And we're very lucky, because that was his great granddad. So not many families can say that, you know, they had their great granddad until they were 14.
No, I mean, very fortunate, and to pass on that message, and imagine a massive keepsake for your son to hopefully pass on and tell the stories and keep that support and that remembering going on for forever and ever. I mean, I remember my granddad, he was a Dunkirk veteran, never told me anything about what happened. Later on in his life, I joined the military service, the RAF, and he was super proud. But one regret I had is that I never asked him any questions. What did he say about, you know, his time? He was in some really difficult campaigns and he saw some sights, you know. What was his take on it? Did he share that with you?
Granddad was a very closed man with that sort of thing too. You know, he would normally talk the leg off the stool, but you see, when it came to his history and the military and the things he experienced, you got very few stories. You know, you got some stories, but you didn't get great detail. And, you know, he didn't like to watch documentaries on TV about it. And it was obviously very raw. You know, you could see a lot of the time, a lot of emotion with Grandad. And he got his silver poppy the November before he passed away. You know, we were very lucky. He got his silver poppy within the local council. But you could see at times when he started to think about what he had gone through, how cutting it was for him. And I don't think anybody will ever understand that unless you were part of it.
No, that's absolutely right. And it seems all too familiar with veterans that they don't really want to relive that their memories and try and block them out. And a lot of people can cope with it, and a lot of people can't. And that's where, you know, people like Blesma come into their own and keep supporting those that are really struggling.
And I think that was such a massive thing for Grandad, you know. And for him, Blesma was amazing, you know, when he was at home, the things they did to support him because he was on his own and we were only going to visit, you know, a couple of times a month. You know, he always had a visitor, he always had somebody that he could talk to. And then when he was here, you know, the reps made, you know, so much contact with him, came and visited him, did everything they could to support him, which was fantastic because whenever we moved him to Northern Ireland, he was isolated. It's not his home. And also there was a language barrier because although we both speak the same language, the accent was impossible for Grandad to master. You know, and extreme locals, he could never understand. So you got a lot of smiling and nodding, but you know, people did take time to do things for him and be with him.
Well, you know, you mentioned the that outreach program, and I believe Fiona runs that up in Northern Ireland. She set up a bit of a WhatsApp group for the event at the Blesma 11K run, and you're a member of that.
Yeah, there seems to be quite a few of us over here doing it, and quite a lot of ex you know, servicemen as well and women doing it over here. So it's nice. It's just nice to see what other people are doing and have some sort of, you know, combined unity between everybody. And although I've never served, I just feel that, you know, I constantly want to do something to give back to what they did and what Grandad did, you know. And it's very hard to share that with this generation. And, you know, hopefully we never have to go through anything like that again. But the concept of remembering it is really important, and I think they need to understand how lucky they are and that a lot of the life they have now wouldn't exist if it wasn't for our grandparents.
No, absolutely. And, you know, from your granddad, some would say that your dad, his son, followed in his footsteps, but a service a little bit closer to my heart.
Yes, he did. He signed up when he was 16. So, and I think he left just after I was born or just before I was born. But Dad was always a very hands-on type of man, like Granddad. So he didn't want to be stuck behind a desk. So he got to a certain stage and then decided that he would bow out gracefully. But I mean, Dad has lots of stories to tell, and he does tell them and shares them with me and with Jake. You know, so that there is a whole lifestyle there, you know, and it's a way of life. You know, we were, you know, hearing Dad's stories and the way he talks about it, you know, he had such a good life doing that and such a good quality of life, and made so many friends, you know, people that he still keeps in touch with now, a second family. And Dad was an only child because Granddad, my dad was born in 1945. So it was quite traumatic at that stage because Granddad lost his leg, and then my granny had TB and she ended up with only one lung. And Dad, for the first bit of his life, was raised by a family friend because they just weren't fit really to look after him. So I think just the way things panned out, that was why he ended up as an only child. So for him, I think the military created that life, that family life, maybe, that he, although he had a very loving relationship with Grandma and Granddad, it just gave him that onus to have a bit more around him, I suppose, that we all kind of want at some point. But he has plenty of stories to tell, and I think it was some of the greatest years of his life from what I can gather, you know.
Really?
Which is good too.
Wow. I could just listen to these stories all day myself. So appreciate you joining us and telling us a little bit more about, you know, service life and how important that is. And I believe, you know, your granddad came back from, he did Arakan and Kohima, some really difficult campaigns, and has lived such an incredible life. And then son carrying it on, and yourself working in army welfare, I believe. So passing on that tradition. But am I right in saying he's been a member of Blesma since 1946?
Yeah, very, very long time, as far as I can remember. You know, a really, really long time, you know. And he was very devoted to the cause. You know, he would have done everything he could to support them. And, you know, even when he was in the home on Remembrance Day, at that stage, he wasn't a lot of the time well enough. Although he was fit enough mentally, he just didn't have the strength. You know, he was an old man, so we didn't take him out a lot of the time. And He did lay a wreath as part of the 100 wreaths with one of the other members from over here. We managed to get him to do that. But, you know, he would always put his beret on and stand and do his own wee thing. And I think that in itself, you know, we don't have to be all singing and dancing and make a show of it. Everybody has their own way of remembering. And I think it's nice that a lot of the older generation do it in their own way. And they're very pensive about it, and as a generation they're not talkers, you know, they don't talk about their feelings or emotions. You know, that's only started to come in, especially with men over the last sort of 10 years. Yeah. You know, it's okay to
we're
share
bad at that.
Stuff. Yeah, so
we need to open up and talk a bit more, and I think a lot of mental health issues might be easier to deal with if you know, we all opened up a little bit more.
Yeah.
You know, I wish my granddad had opened up a bit more and told me some stories. It's the one thing that I miss. I'm glad you were in a similar boat, but we're all the same. Thanks for continuing your granddad's legacy and supporting Blesma. Am I right in saying you're a little bit injured at the moment now?
Yeah, I've got terrible tendonitis in my Achilles heel, so. Well, I was training all summer and then had to stop. So I'm trying, I will do it, but it'll probably be December before
a delayed attempt. But yeah. You'll get back to us and you'll let us know how you get on.
I will definitely let you know when I have done it, yes.
Well, we wish you a speedy recovery. Thanks very much for sharing your family amazing story. It just seems like one of those life's gems. And it's so important to commemorate his memory and also, you know, supporting those in need in the future. So thank you very much for joining us today.
Thank you for having me. Thank you.
And look after yourself.
You too. Thank you very much. Take care.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Cheers, Jessica.
Good morning, my name's Fiona Morrison, the Blesma Outreach Officer for Northern Ireland. As you can see this morning, it's a little bit wet, a little bit mucky, but I'm 10k into my cycle. I think after listening to Jessica's interview, you can say that it was really heartwarming, full of wonderful memories and stories. Memories and stories that Jessica can then share with her own children in an effort to bring our history alive. So for me, I think today is a really poignant day as well, that I can also share my memories with Arthur, affectionately known as Bomber, and how he used to introduce himself. 2 years ago, I had the privilege to stand at his side with one of our younger members, Brian, and watch him lay a wreath on behalf of Blesma. This was an extremely proud moment for his family, for him, and a very humbling experience for me. Then last year, we took part in his wonderful 100th birthday celebrations. He had a Blesma 100th cake, and we surprised him. And that was a fantastic afternoon. Sadly but peacefully, on Christmas Day 2019, Bomber said farewell to this world. So today, we will remember him and so many, many more men and women like him. So how are we doing that in Northern Ireland? So today we have Colin Shields, who is laying a wreath on behalf of Blesma at a local cenotaph. And then we have our members, family members like Jessica and partners, who are all taking part in the virtual 11K. Some of these members have already completed their challenge yesterday, and they did this to enable them today to then support other members and family members. So how did I get signed up for the 11K? Well, as you know, the pandemic has changed how we deliver our work, how we operate, and we moved into a virtual world very quickly in March when we came into lockdown. So when I could see the guys signing up and partners signing up, I thought, well, that is a great way for us to connect and be together whilst apart. So here I am. We have members who are taking on the challenge today by cycling on hand cycles, a ski erg, a recumbent bike, and walking. And I think the message that clearly sends is the Blesma member will do whatever needs to be done to get the job done. So I think today when I go home, we will do what a lot of people are doing at 11. We will stand on our doorsteps and we will remember.
So let's take a moment to remember some of the reasons why the Blesma community are coming together this morning. We'll start with a special video message from Paul Findlay, who was a corporal in the Royal Signals. Paul was recently recognised in the Queen's Birthday Honours list, becoming an MBE for his charitable services.
Hi, I'm Paul from Blesma, the Limbless Veterans. I'm one of the support officers that works for the organisation, and I'm also a Limbless Veteran myself after losing my leg in Afghanistan in 2009. Blesma were one of the first organisations to support me and my family after I suffered my injury, and they've been there for hundreds and thousands of veterans ever since World War I when we were formed. We look to support all of our veterans and their families for life, and although times have changed significantly since 1930, we still look to support everyone and ensure that as many of our veterans have independent and fulfilling lives as possible. Although times are difficult just now with the coronavirus, there are still plenty of ways you can support Blesma and ensure that we can continue to do the same work as possible. You can check out www.blesma.org and see some of our virtual events. You can still donate online, and by doing so, you will ensure that we can support our veterans for the next 100 years. Thank you.
Okay, I'm Badger up there, guys. This is your aircraft landing there. So, Badger, we start making your way to flight line.
Rush, rush, rush. It's always last minute. It's always it's either waiting around or then rush, rush.
My name's Paul Burns, and this is a very close friend of mine, Fudge, who's 3 years old now. I've been a very close companion for all of that time. I'm a member of Blesma, and have been for some 33 years now, since I was blown up in Northern Ireland while serving with the 2nd Battalion of the Parachute Regiment in 1979. I'd always wanted to join the Army. From a child, was it the war films of the 60s and the 70s, or the toy soldiers, the army cadets? I just felt that that was a career for me. I wanted to serve, and I wanted to serve in a regiment that was perhaps a little bit more exciting than the average. And the parachute regiment seemed to have that appeal, something a little bit different. We were on convoy. We were going down to the border, to Newry, to take over of one of the other companies. There was a roadside bomb hidden in a semi-trailer, laden with hay. I think it was 3 beer kegs, apparently, 800 pound of explosive. As we drove by, it was detonated by radio control. The truck I was in was completely destroyed. There were eight of us in it. There was 2 of us survived. When the Casivac and everyone else had come to clear the area and sort things out, the IRA set a secondary device off, which killed 18 died altogether. It's the biggest loss of life in a single incident since the last war. I was badly burnt in the incident. I lay burning, and I was out of it. I was away with the fairies for about 6-7 weeks before reality really came back to me. The blast smashed my legs, smashed my foot, both my feet, smashed my arm. My hand was cut in two, I lost teeth. I lay burning, my legs burnt to the bone in places.
I remember someone coming to visit me from Blesma while I was in hospital. I did get involved, and it was very valuable. My first real involvement was with sailing. I went and sailed at Cowswick, and through that first involvement back then in, I think it was about 1984, I'm now a yacht master and cruising instructor. It's turned my life around and given me a big part of my life. The charity's evolved a lot. We have a new membership emerging through Iraq and Afghanistan. Now it's a charity for everybody. And there's a lot of interaction. We try to get the younger guys to interact with the older guys. We're going to Austria with Blesmer and learning how to ski bike. I immediately fell in love with it, saw the potential, and became an instructor after a couple of years.
If it makes someone's life better, for me telling what happened to me, I think that's a positive thing. To see the turnaround, to see guys come along on the trip, it changes their lives. To see them learn what I learned all those years ago.
The joy that that gives me, to see the guys coming through the system and enjoying what I enjoyed, that knowing, that feeling of freedom that it gives you, and be able to pass that on, it is second to none. 1982, I got involved. I came to work here at Netherhaven, and as soon as I started parachuting, I longed to get a limbless Blesmer freefall team together.
I was invited to be trained as a parachute rigger with the Red Devils. Started jumping, was on the display teams. I've done nearly 1,000 jumps now.
And you really are free when you're in the air. Blesmer gave me the opportunity to try things that I never thought I'd be able to do, or never had thought that I'd want to do. And in trying them, turned my life around. I've dived, I've sailed, all these things that Blesmer had given the opportunity to try. It's amazing, one door closes and others open. You just got to see those doors and give them a little bit of a push sometime and try these things. Try everything you can possibly do, because there's so many things out there that will give you your life purpose and give you so much enjoyment. Looking back to when I was 18 and laid in hospital, I had no idea what I was going to do and what my future might hold for me. All I knew that my world had stopped. And to be able to sit here now, having experienced all the things that I have, I feel very lucky, very, very lucky. I feel my life is very full and very interesting, and I feel very lucky.
Our runners today are helping to raise vital funds to help injured and limbless veterans. Now let's see how these lot are getting on.
Hi, my name's Jack Broughton. I'm a Blesmer member. I served 5 years in the army and I'm a Bologna amputee. Just about to take part in Blesmer's virtual 11K challenge, inaugural 11K challenge. And it's going to be a bit of a lick. But the least I can do to say thank you to Blesmer is push myself a little bit, for they have supported me through thick and thin, through every aspect of our life, and not just me, but my family. It sums up Blesmer to me is earlier this year when I was in hospital, Andy Barlow, our regional support officer, was always there checking up, making sure I had everything I needed and that I was comfortable. And other Blesmer members were checking in through him to see how I was. It's more than just a charity, Blesmer. It's a family. I've met some absolutely gleaming people through it. Some inspirational characters that are always pushing themselves and trying to better themselves and not give up. Remembrance to me is a time of reflection. Remember those that paid the ultimate sacrifice, but also a time to be grateful for everything that we have and all the freedoms that we have today because of those that went before us and paid that sacrifice. So I'd like to wish everyone that's taking part in the challenge today the best of luck, and thank everyone for their support, and hope everyone stays safe, and just thank Blesmer and thank them for all the hard work they do. So cheers guys and have a good day.
Morning, my name's Pauline Strang. I'm doing this 11k run on behalf of my husband Colin. He lost his leg in Iraq in 2003. And Blesma have been great throughout, and we're very grateful.
Hello. Hello, it's Charlie and Valerie. We're halfway through the 11K remembrance for Blesma. We are in Hurlbridge. As you can see, the River Crouch behind us, very pretty. It's a really nice place to run to. I'm running today because my husband works for Blesma, but also because my two granddads were in the war and were prisoner of war. So it's a cause quite close to my heart.
And I'm running in memory of my nan because my granddad died in the Second World War, and my nan did a lot of good work for the Royal British Legion. She carried the flag at the Scimitar, and as children we used to go around and collect money for poppies on Armistice Day with my nan. And she died, it's almost 30 years ago today, so I'm running in memory of her.
And Charlie did some really nice poppies for us to wear today.
Plastic free poppies we made.
Good luck everyone, good luck to all the other runners, and thank you Blesma for organising such a great event.
Bye. Bye, good luck with your run.
Bye.
Hi, I'm Emma, the Blesma Outreach Officer for Scotland, and I'm taking part in the virtual 11K for Remembrance. I'm cycling around my three war memorials. Here's the first one at Stevenson. That's me, 11 kilometres to the third war memorial. Just got to cycle home.
So hi, Neris, how are you?
Hi, I'm great, Sean. Thank you.
Well, it's a shame we can't meet in person, but great to chat with you virtually. Ahead of this inaugural Blesma 11K remembrance event, which I believe you're taking part in.
Yes, absolutely. As soon as I heard about it, I signed up.
But, you know, we go back quite a while, skiing, water skiing. You've always been fairly active as long as I can remember, and it always hasn't been that way though, has it, since your accident? But I always remember you were always keen to get stuck into everything, but in particular this year you've done some crazy challenges. Now tell us a little bit about them.
Well, Blesma literally saved my life and turned my life around about 5 years ago, and took me from being bedbound and unable to look after myself to what I am now. So this year has been about to give back and maybe help others see a way forwards. So I set up a crazy triple challenge, all in aid of Blesma. And the first of those challenges was a 105-mile continuous push. It was based on an event that I can never normally take part in because it's an off-road Lakeland 100 running event. But this year with COVID, trying to turn a negative into a positive, I was like, hang on, I can take part because it's virtual. I can create my own route. And the support that I had on that 105 miles was amazing. It was very painful, though.
And it took you how long?
22 hours, 33 minutes, I think.
Wow. I mean, that's incredible, pushing a wheelchair for that sort of length of time. This is an opportunity, this event, to, you know, give our members, staff and supporters the opportunity to commemorate and support our veterans and people that we've lost in the past and on this nationally important day. So how important is it for people to understand the work of Blesma and how it's still needed in a modern society?
I think for me, that's been part of what this triple challenge has been about, has been raising awareness of Blesma. Lots of people have never heard of the charity. And as I said, they changed my life. They help both veterans and serving members of any armed forces, people that have lost a limb, so an amputation, lost use of a limb, like myself, I'm paralyzed, or lost the use of their eyesight. So they cover a lot of injuries. And those injuries don't have to be in service. They can be, but they don't have to be. And I think the really special thing about Blesma is that it's not just about supporting the injured person. It's also our family, our friends. If we pass away and become widow or widowers, you know, they're there for our entire life, supporting all of the people around us, which, you know, without the people around me, I would not be able to achieve and do the crazy things I do.
So you mentioned about injuries and that, and we'll get onto yours shortly. But what was your life like pre-accident, incident, and, you know, your life in the military and how you saw your future? And you were actually supporting other people.
Yeah, you know, I was extremely lucky. I was a combat medic. I got to teach traumatic medical skills to the guys going out onto the front line. So I myself haven't been to the front line, but I taught the guys going out basically the skills they needed on their worst day when something awful had happened. They'd been blown up, shot, maybe another accident had happened, how they could make the best effort to save their mate's life on their worst day. And, you know, it was a phenomenal thing to be able to do. And I've always grown up with a caring edge. My mum's completely blind. So I was brought up in a household where disability was obviously very evident. Although growing up, I didn't actually notice it at all. But I also had a crazy adrenaline up for anything streak. So the army allowed me to travel the world, taught me to ski, downhill mountain bike, jump out of planes, you know, so it really fulfilled both sides of me. So my life before the accident was very full. It was very fulfilled. I felt like me.
You mentioned your family there and your upbringing. I think you mentioned something about your dad was a bit of a carer for your mum, but he also became your full-time carer as well. Now tell us a little bit about, you know, your accident and how that sort of transpired, that your dad ended up supporting and caring for you.
So our family's always been really close-knit, my mum, my dad and my sister. And my mum can't take, you know, we say carer, but they were a relationship, you know. My mum's worked full-time her whole life. She worked for the prison service. You know, this isn't a woman that needs taking care of, but they just had a different balance in their relationship. And in October 2008, I was going along a straight road on a motorbike, doing less than 10 miles an hour, and a car reversed from off the curb from behind a bus stop and took me and the motorbike over. And I mean, in my lifetime, I must have crashed skis, mountain bikes, you know, hundreds of times. And when that happened, I just assumed that everything would be fine. You know, your body fixes itself, you bounce back. And people say to me, but you're a medic, you knew that didn't always happen. But my body had always done that. So I just had that expectation that I would just fix. And a year or so later, it was really, really evident that the nerve damage to my legs was really quite extensive. I had horrific burning pain all of the time, like someone was pouring burning oil on my lower body. And I tried many, many treatments for the NHS. They did everything they could, but eventually it just didn't go my way. I went in for a really standard treatment. My body reacted really badly to it, and I was left paralysed from the chest down.
And you were such a positive person before and then later on, but there wasn't always that time, was there? I mean, you found yourself with some real mental health issues. You just sort of touch on that and then maybe how Blesma first approached you and helped you in that situation.
Yeah, so when I ended up paralysed from chest down, you know, it'd been a long road of treatment and I'd ended up on many, many medications and they were added to after that incident. And I was left bedbound, weighing over 18 stone on 12 or so medications, none of which were really great together. And again, no one's fault. It was just all needed at the time. But I had 24-hour carers and I just couldn't see a way forward. So I literally felt like this creature that was wasting air and my family and friends' time because they'd still turn up. You know, and I hated myself so much that I turned my head on them to ignore them when they came round. And, you know, the only light I could see was making a plan to finish it. And ironically, I couldn't even go through with that because my drugs were out of my reach. So I couldn't even do that for myself. So I think that was the point that I felt there was no returning back to who I used to be or to a useful member of my family or society. And then Blesma showed up in my life, you know, and I'd never heard of them. I'd been injured at this point some 6 years. And this guy appeared. That day will stay with me forever when they said, yes, we're going to take you skiing to Colorado. And I was like, what? I can't even sit up. And this crazy charity is going to try and fly me to Colorado. And then they're going to give me back the activity that literally was me, you know, the adrenaline, the thought, the you know, the multiple thinking at the same time. Skiing was, you know, everything sports-wise that I loved. But, you know, that trip wasn't easy. I was still in a really bad place. I wasn't a pleasant person. And interestingly, when they first put me on the mono ski, some joker, when you're stood up and able-bodied, you ski on two skis. When you're paralyzed from the chest down, someone invented that you ski on one. And, you know, my brain just couldn't compute how that was ever going to work. And I resembled that old school toy. Do you remember the Weebles? The kind of, you know, the one way? Yeah, that's exactly what I looked like. And Sean, you're a pro mono skier, so you know that feeling of learning and falling over literally like every like 10 seconds. And when the instructor turned around and said, Neris, just relax, just put some effort into yourself and try, I burst into tears. And then we got to the bottom. And I thought he'd like got hold of the back of me and skied me down. And he literally came running over in his ski boots like Bambi and pressed play on his phone. And that moment changed my life because I'd skied myself to the bottom of the mountain. And it might have only been 150 meters, but that 150 meters was my Everest at that point.
So Neris, it's been quite a hard struggle over the years. And I'm sure you've learned a lot of lessons on the way. What would you say to others that are suffering or dealing with mental and physical issues?
That it's very, 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 very hard. But that reaching out or asking for help, however that is, really has helped me. And sometimes I have to start my mental health journey, or if I've been physically ill, with really small goals, you know, sitting outside for 5 minutes in my back garden, maybe setting myself the goal of that day of sending a WhatsApp to my best friend, you know, and people see me doing these crazy challenges. So they'll probably be really surprised that some days those are my sole goal for the day. But it's definitely a toolkit that I've kind of armed myself with along the years by looking at other people, including yourself, you know, watching you doing ski cross and, you know, going head to head with three other mono skiers down all these jumps. I was like, wow, okay, if that's possible, that looks epic. Right, okay, that's the goal for, you know, in years time. What can I do right today? Okay, let's go outside. Can I wheel around the block? And so those small goals are super, super important. And also just being kind to yourself. And I'm really bad for this, that when I start feeling awful, the self-talk in my head is not a friendly thing. You know, I expect far too much from myself when I'm having a hard time. So I say to people, you know, and it's always easier to give advice than listen to your own advice, is that when you start to struggle, try and make the conversation that you have with yourself in your head a positive one, friendly one, trying to make it a neutral one. So because we are our harshest critics.
You say, Neris, about, you know, we all put on that facade of everything's okay, but inside, you know, there's often times when we're hurting, whether it be physical or mental. and you need to reach out, and you really touch base on that. And it's not just Blesma that offer all these activities, but they offer a lot of support as well. And I think it's, they say it's good to talk, isn't it? And I think a lot of us are of that opinion that we don't talk enough. So thanks very much for bringing that out. But you also mentioned about some crazy challenges. And these are your goals and your stepping stones to move on to bigger things. So, you know, a 105-mile wheelchair push, a 100-mile bike ride, which is like, you know, four marathons. And then you add topping it off with the Channel swim. I mean, yeah. That's crazy. It
didn't exactly go to plan, really.
Go on, tell us. And is it unfinished business?
It is absolutely unfinished business. So I attempted to swim the channel, the English Channel, solo. So starting in Dover, obviously hoping to finish in Calais. And it was a life-changing experience that I wouldn't change. It didn't end the way I wanted it to. But swimming into the sunrise, I was swimming east because of the tide and the current as the sun came up. And it was, it just went from this pitch black to this vivid purple. And then the sun appeared over the horizon, and you could almost feel the curve of the world because you were on horizon level. And my words will never be able to do it justice. But also just the amount of time that people gave me, you know, in all the training. I had friends come out and kayak for 8 hours straight for me alongside at swimming pace. You know, it wasn't exactly the exciting world day for them. But they spent hours in the cold. My parents walked up and down the Thames for me between Hampton and Kingston, you know, watching me swimming and making sure I was safe. My sister did the same thing. She kayaked, you know, and so all of these people gave up their time, you know, and their care for me. So the channel was a roller coaster before it started. It's called the Dover Coaster. So I got given a date and we drove. We kind of all arrived at my house like the Avengers, my team. We assembled and we all drove to Dover. We got there and my pilot, which is basically the boat captain, kind of, he's normally this really gregarious little seafaring man. And he kind of was slumping towards me and it was like, oh, that doesn't look good. And he was like, do you know what? Crazy swell from the North Sea has just appeared from nowhere and we're not going tonight. So we've driven all the way to Dover and got all of that adrenaline going to not even get in the water. And then we had this delayed wait because of weather and storms and, you know, all this, that and the other. So a couple of weeks later, got another call. And again, my Avengers all just turned up, took days off work, leave, drove from Bath and, you know, all over the place. And I think, you know, I really wanted to achieve it for myself, but also for them. But 9 hours in, it wasn't to be. I was swimming along and it was suddenly as if somebody had got the Harry Potter invisibility cloak. Now, I'm going to sound a little loopy here. But so I'm in the middle of the sea. There's this big boat next to me that's been there for 9 hours. And then suddenly it disappears. But in my brain, it's fine because the guys on the boat, some of them are ex-military, and we all know how bad our banter and our humour is. So I thought they'd put the Harry Potter invisibility cloak over the top of the boat and hidden it. That's what I thought they'd done. So I shouted at them to stop messing about. And then the next time I turned, the boat was kind of there and I was like, oh, they're listening. They've kind of lifted it a little bit, turned back and it was gone again. So I stopped to kind of almost say to them, what are you playing at? You know, it's not funny. And when I started swimming, I swam in completely the wrong direction. And the next thing I remember, we were almost back at Dover and I got hypothermia at like 32 degrees body temperature. But I wouldn't let them off the boat. I wouldn't let the medics take me off the boat until the captain had shook my hand that he would rebook me for next year. Do it all again. I mean,
some real mind tricks going on there, and you're absolutely mental to be going back and doing it. But getting to that state of delirium is just, yeah, crazy moments. But absolutely fantastic for for attempting it, and I know for a fact you'll be back and going to smash it. But something you know you touched on was the support of family and friends, but also charities like Blesma have a real impact on people's well-being and support as they move further. But we're actually nearly out of time, and we're going to ask you, you've done plenty of preparation for this 11-kilometre event at the weekend. You'll be doing it on Sunday, I believe?
Yes.
Yeah? Tell us where you're doing it and who you're going to be doing it with, if anybody.
So obviously with the pandemic going on, we're having to kind of, you know, play by the seat a little bit because the rules are changing in different areas. But at the moment, the plan is to meet in Windsor Great Park. I'm really lucky to live in such a stunning area in Berkshire. And a group of us are going to meet 10 o'clock. We're going to walk to the top of the walk, which overlooks Windsor Castle, for 11 a.m. and spend our minute silence looking over Windsor and remembering the people that have passed on, but also the people that are still with us, maybe the people that are still struggling. And that's really important, that Remembrance Day is about remembering everyone that's in our lives. And I think it's just a beautiful moment in our busy lives to just take some time out and just be still and be at peace. So my family are joining me, some friends. We're going to split into whatever groups are required by the COVID rules, and then spend the rest of the afternoon, morning, walking around Windsor Great Park, and people can come and go. So if 11K is not for them, that doesn't mean that they can't take part. Come and join us at the top of the long walk at 11 o'clock. So it's a really flexible thing because it's about the inclusivity. Some people, 11K is too far. Some people, 11K is not enough. So I've got some people cycling from miles away and then doing the 11K walk with us. So that's going to be Sunday the 8th.
Brilliant. Well, I mean, you couldn't have said that much better. But in such an iconic place as well to be that setting, I'm sure there's got going to be lots of other members and that you'll pass in that specific area. So all the best with it. It's been great catching up with you and hearing about your current escapades. An incredible story, even though, you know, we go back quite a while. It's nice to hear some of the other challenges that you've faced. And it's obvious you feel like a real great debt of gratitude towards Blesma. And the way you're paying it forward and supporting and raising awareness is absolutely fantastic. So thank you on their behalf. So we need your support to engage and offer people like Neris a future. Now, this is a recorded interview. As you know, Neris will be joining us on Sunday live for the Blesma Remembrance 11K event. I wish her all the best. But I think we can go to you live.
Good morning. We're here in stunning Windsor Great Park with Windsor Castle in the mist in the background. We're about halfway through our Blesma Virtual 11K for Remembrance Sunday. I'm Neris and I'm a Blesma member. In 2008, I was serving as a combat medic in the army and I was hit by a car and left paralysed from the chest down. Now, Blesma means so much to me because they literally saved my life. They took me from bedbound to being able to live independently. But today, they've given me the opportunity, despite the pandemic and none of our remembrance services going ahead, to join with everybody and remember those that we've lost.
So next up, I want to share Scott Yarrington's story with you. This is the story Scott's been sharing with young people as part of Making Generation R and the campaign delivered by Blesma and the Drive Project. The campaign supports injured veterans by training them to take their inspired stories and about finding resilience and overcoming adversity to young people and frontline key workers across the UK. Over 100,000 people have already benefited from these talks. The aim is to help young people and key workers develop strategies to deal with adversity and overcoming everyday issues. Here's Scott's story.
I was lying there on a road looking up. My map was out to my right, my GPS to my left. I went to reach over to grab my GPS, and that's when I noticed that my arm had been blown open. I could see right down to the bone. That's when I knew it was me that had been hit. I didn't know at this point, but both my legs had been blown off. My right leg had been blown off up to my ankle. And I had just bone from my ankle all the way up to my knee. My left leg was then blown off straight up to my knee and nothing else below it. I had to put tourniquets on the tops of my legs. So we get back and we go into the base, and then lads from another platoon pick me up on the back of the stretcher and run me onto the back of a helicopter, which is there waiting for me already. On the back of the helicopter, there's a doctor on the back, and she tells me her name, and I'm like, please just put me to sleep, I'm in so much pain. And she's like, yeah, I'm going to put you to sleep now, don't worry. And that was it. That was the end of my time in Afghanistan. Fast forward 3 weeks, I wake up in a hospital, QE in Birmingham. From there, lying there with tubes coming out of my mouth, wires all over my face, wires all over my arm up in a sling. And my dad's sitting at the end of the bed. And my dad looks really emotional. He doesn't really look emotional normally. He's a bit of an old school bloke, doesn't show his emotions, never seen him cry or anything. But I could tell while he's sitting at the end of my bed that he'd been crying. I was like, trying to get his attention, Dad, what's happened to me? I couldn't talk, but I had these tubes in my mouth. He was like, I was like looking at my arm, I was looking at Sting, and I was like, if I'm okay, he's like, we don't know yet. We don't know what's going to happen with your arm. I was like, okay. I was like, my legs, and he's like, no. I'm like, one? He's like, no, both legs. I was like, okay. And then I go back into unconsciousness. Then I wake up in the middle of the night. And tubes that were in my mouth just feel like they were suffocating me. So I start trying to voice and I need to speak, I need to talk. And I don't feel like I can breathe properly. So I start voicing through these tubes and voicing through. And then all these alarms start going off because I've bit through the valve and the air's not going into me. And all my vital signs are starting to go down. And then I go back into unconsciousness. And they wake me up that night, and they're like, you're very lucky. You beat through your tube and there's no air going through into your lungs. I was like, okay. I felt really sore all the way down my chest. I had scars on the ends of my lips from where all the tape and pipes had been through me. And that night I was lying there, and there was a nurse at the end of my bed. And I didn't really remember what had happened with my dad at that point. And I was like, okay, so she was talking to me normally, like, how'd you feel and things like that. I was like, yeah, can't wait to get out of here. I just want to go and play football with my son. And she's like, you do realise that you've lost both your legs. And my world just fell apart again. And that is the most vivid time that I remember being told that I've lost my legs. So I'm absolutely distraught. Crying, she's distraught after telling me, and she's crying. She'd been told that I'd already been told, but she could tell from my reaction that I just couldn't remember it. And that was one of the longest nights that I remember after being injured. She's there sitting with me, comforting me. And it's a really rough night. While I was at Headley Court, I got with my girlfriend at the time. And we'd moved in together. I was at Headley Court, got a house up in Birmingham. And then things started getting serious. We got engaged. And when we got engaged, we decided that we'd like to try for a kid because of my injuries. I couldn't have kids naturally, so we had to go to the Birmingham Women's Hospital to have IVF. Now, IVF is one of the most stressful things that you'll ever go through. But we got very lucky the first time, and we had a little boy. In 2013, Alfie was a miracle child. Can't have any more. We haven't got any more tries left for IVF. So he's sort of like our world. And in 2017, me and Rachel went off and got married with our close family at Disneyland in Florida. And we had Mickey Mouse and Minnie Mouse and Beauty and the Beast there with us while we got married. And that same year, I went to Toronto, Canada, and took part in the Invictus Games in the wheelchair basketball, where we got a bronze medal. Absolutely brilliant time over there. We had such a laugh, all the different countries coming together. It was just the best atmosphere that you could actually imagine.
I love my time in the military. It was fantastic. It's everything I was looking for. You know, it's fun, but coupled with that bit of discipline that I needed. It was just a great adventure. Constantly learning, trying new things. It's everything I wanted. Hadn't got injured, definitely still be there now. In 2009, serving with 59 Commando Royal Engineers, I stepped on an IED, so I lost one leg above the knee and one below. Remembrance is a huge thing to me. I'm lucky enough to be involved with my local church and the silence that they do at the cenotaph every year. I started off just attending, and then a couple of ex-servicemen got me more and more involved and realised that they were almost passing the mantle over to me a little bit because I was younger, and obviously took a keen interest in it being supported locally. It's something that I think is a responsibility for people like me to get involved in these events and also spread the word about remembrance. It is about remembering those that have paid the ultimate sacrifice and showing respect and showing that won't be forgotten, and that we do appreciate everything they did and everything they gave. So for me personally, it's a huge event every year, and I'm very proud to hopefully represent the Blesmer community well at that.
So hi there, Andy, how are you, and where are you calling us from?
Good morning. I'm doing all right, yes, working from home. I'm currently near Bryce Norton at what used to be RAF Little Risington. 3 years ago, I had the opportunity to buy part of the officer's mess complex, which has been converted into houses. So I'm currently sat in what was the officer's mess at a former RAF base.
Wow, so you've got a promotion then from back in your service days, eh?
Very much so,
does it feel
so,
like
yes.
It? No, you
it's
mentioned Bryce Norton. Yeah, same for me as well. So you mentioned, that area and Little Risington. It's an air base as well, back of World War II, I believe, a bomber and a storage site and stuff like that. But you also commemorated something quite important recently. Just tell us a little bit about that.
Yes, it was the Battle of Britain 80th anniversary. And part of that, the Royal Air Force Museums, again, they were also doing virtual runs. And their Spitfire 10K... I was able to get permission from the RAF to use the runway to actually do my run, and ran the whole 10K on the runway and managed to finish an imaginary finish line, but myself on my own running down the centre line of the original runway, which was...
Now, I can imagine that's a big old runway because it's an old bomber base, so massive wide open space. Is that under lockdown restrictions and all that stuff going on from now, is that a place you might be running the 11K from?
I've asked permission and originally was told no, because the cadet force run the volunteer glider squadron obviously on that runway. But given the new restrictions, the glider squadron are not allowed to gather. and I'm just waiting to see if the key holder can get the permission to allow me back onto the site on my own, with supervision by one or two others. But it will be me running down the runway.
It's such a place with a lot of history, so I imagine it'd be even more poignant for you doing it in a place where so much has happened.
I was listening to the Spotify playlist that the RAF Museum had put together, and the first time I listened to it was whilst I was doing the Spitfire 10K, and I hadn't realised that they'd put some Spitfire sound effects in between some of the different music tracks. And when you're halfway down what is effectively a live runway, and just out of nowhere you start hearing aircraft noise coming through your ears, you then start very quickly checking the skies to see what's coming.
Turning around.
And then realise it's coming through the headset.
Fantastic. Now, I believe you joined up in 1995. And I think at that time I was heading up to the Outer Hebrides, RAF Benbecula at that time. But you were in training. So what did you... You're doing in the military, and how was service life?
I was a mechanical transport driver, and best time of my life. Absolutely loved it. From a very early age, I wanted to be a truck driver in the RAF. And as soon as they would let me join at the age of 17, that's exactly what I joined up to do.
So it was a bit of a dream job then, yeah?
Always, yeah. Still is now.
It still is now, and I'm sure
I'd still be there, you know.
Yeah, you'd still be there, and I'd be in exactly the same boat. I was a lifer if it wasn't for my accident. But, you know, fond memories, but something happened, and it sort of forced you into medical retirement. Are you able to tell us a little bit about that?
Yes, I was on my way into camp one morning. Obviously, tasks needed to happen. I was on my way, not necessarily the normal road that I was on. And I was then involved in, I tend to class it as quite a serious accident. And my motorbike went one way, I went the other, and I ended up underneath the rear wheels of a four-wheel drive. And she then had to reverse off me. And yeah, since that point, my right arm has not worked.
So you've got the loss of use of a limb, which is quite poignant when, you know, with regards to Blesma, and I'm sure that's why you support the charity for all they do for people in similar positions to yourself. But how did you cope mentally and physically after your accident?
To be honest, the first few years, I kind of turned my back on the Air Force, on the veterans, on charities. I felt very alone, and I dealt with it, as a lot of veterans do, with alcohol. And in terms of get used to it, I'm 20 years into this injury, and I still am getting used to it. The first 14, 15 years, I wasn't involved in any charities. I didn't do any sort of charitable fundraising for veterans. Eddie, stop. It was all very much, I looked after myself and I got on with things. And 2015 was when I realised that I was basically running away from my problems, drinking through my problems. I was 18 stone. I was a heavy drinker, still working all day every day, but it wasn't uncommon to nip out and have two or three large vodka and cokes with my lunch. And eventually, big meltdown in 2015. And fortunately, earlier that year, a friend of mine had introduced me to the BSO in the Northeast, Pete Shields, and introduced me to Blesma, who at that point had been recognising loss of use of limbs as opposed to just being purely limbless. And Blesma welcomed me in with open arms. When I then had my meltdown, Pete just became my superhero, you know.
Wow.
He, whatever buttons needed to be pressed, the right people were involved within hours. The right people were in my house within hours. Skype calls with different mental health support teams. All of that happened within a couple of days. Whereas if you mention it to your GP at the time, it weeks, months, you know, a 7-month waiting list to get in to speak to mental health providers in the NHS. You know, the next morning I was on a Skype call with a mental health provider.
So, I mean, you mentioned it there, but these BSOs, the Blesma Support Officers, are just so important out there in the community. And it's really nice that Blesma's opened it from just Limbless, which was probably set up back in World War II. We were getting a lot of injuries back there. But now it encompasses people that just lost odd limbs, like myself, like yourself. You know, but it just tells us the importance of Blesma to you.
Well, that first, basically, I got a call. How do you deal with your mental health? And one of those things was through scuba diving. And very quickly, it transpired that there was a Blesma scuba trip being organised. And how it happened so quickly and easily, I don't know. But a place became available. And I got to meet some new Blesma members, and I went to Egypt for a week to do some scuba diving. And again,
fantastic.
It was the first thing I'd done for a long, long time with veterans. I didn't know anybody else disabled, you know.
Yeah.
And suddenly I'm about to go and spend a week on a boat in the Red Sea with 18 other fellas.
Well, I really support the
very apprehensive to actually get on the trip, you know.
Yeah, no, I mean, I can't say too much about sport and how that's helped in my rehabilitation, but also getting back with like-minded people in similar situations. And
yeah,
although it's difficult in the first instance, isn't it, to overcome that, once you start chatting, you realize you know, you miss that military banter.
Very much so.
And getting back into it. So I'm not going to feel sorry for you too much.
I knew that the scuba diving would be fantastic. I've dived there before. I'm a competent diver. I learned to dive with an able-bodied dive school and adapted my routine to suit my disability.
Yeah.
And be able to pass on some of that knowledge to other disabled divers. Straight away was like, well, this is what I want to be doing. I want to be these guys. But it was the evenings on the boat that mentally helped more than being in the water. Fred, stop it.
Yeah, so it's not just that sport, but you know, the mental aspect of what it gives you being around people like that. Let's get on to something else then. I know we share a similar passion, and I think we're both petrol heads. We love wheels and engines of all descriptions. So tell us a little bit about that. I know you've been involved with Formula One.
I did for a couple of years. I was working within the IT support team for the Renault Formula One team. However, through not abusing my body as such, but all the years of dealing with my issues, I ended up with gallstones. I then had pancreatitis, lots of various health issues that were under control. And then I got the job with Formula One. Fantastic. And the lifestyle within Formula One just doesn't suit what transpired to be type 2 diabetes. So I had to stop doing all the traveling, going to the races, going to the support races, young driver training, show events. You know, it's almost the dream job, but it's all or nothing. It's full on for most of every month. You're out of the country doing something else to then try and incorporate a controlled diet, controlled exercise, proper night's rest, all of the things that control diabetes, all went out of the window for 2.5 years. And eventually just advised, you know, this isn't the lifestyle for you anymore. Look, good job.
So I think people, when they look at us, they can see a physical disability, but they don't actually appreciate what goes on either mentally or the ancillary issues as well along with it. You know, many of them are not visible to a regular person that doesn't know your condition. So you've dealt with all these health issues throughout, you know, your life since that accident. But you've gone on, and now you support and you have a focus to help others. You know, just tell me, you know, how's that transpired? Where's that come from?
I think a lot of it is a bit of what can I give back through Blesma, because Blesma have obviously helped me so much. At the moment, I'm mentally in a good place. I'm physically in a good place. I don't necessarily... I've been accused by some of the staff at Blesma of being a very easy member because I don't ask for help. And yet, if Blesma need anything, I will drop everything. And it, like a simple interview like this, you know, I will happily do this. Run around an airfield on Sunday. Not a problem. Where do you need me? What do you need me to do?
But I love that. And I think it's all about... Sorry.
What can you do for me? You know, at the moment, there are people out there that they need the support more than I do. And whatever I can do to not allow them to, but support them, I will do so, you know. And, you know, there are a number of charities that I am involved in. I currently work for an animal rescue charity. You know, I seem to be fully involved in the charity lifestyle, you know.
Well, it seems to have taken over your life in a very positive way.
Yes.
And it's fantastic to see that transformation. But for now, I think we can say enjoy Sunday as best you can. I hope you get out on the runway and get to remember those and just envisage all them planes landing, taking off, what they're going to do, and all them servicemen and women of the past, you know, and continue on with your selfless quest to support others. Much appreciated on behalf of Blesma. So have a great day. I look forward to seeing you, you know, on Sunday and seeing some pictures.
Fantastic.
Thanks very much for joining us, Andy, and all the best.
Thank you. Cheers.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Some of our members have put together a piece of work they'd like to share with us.
With proud thanksgiving, a mother for her children. England mourns for her dead across the sea. Flesh of her flesh they were, spirit of her spirit, fallen in the cause of the free.
Solemn the drums thrill, death august and royal, sing sorrow up into immortal spheres. There is music in the mist of desolation and a glory that shines upon our tears.
They were with songs to the battle, they were young, straight of limb, true of eye, steady and aglow. They were staunch to the end against odds encountered. They fell with their faces to the foe.
They shall not grow old, as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun, and in the morning, we will remember them.
They mingle not with their laughing comrades again. They sit no more at familiar tables of home. They have no lot in our labour of the daytime, and they sleep beyond England's foam.
But where our desires are, and our hopes profound, felt as a wellspring that is hidden from sight, to the innermost heart of their own land they are known, as the stars are known to the night.
As the stars that shall be bright when we are dust, moving in marches upon the heavenly plain, as the stars that are starry in the time of our darkness, to the end, to the end, they remain.
We will remember them. We will remember them.
Thank you to everybody that's joined us this morning, to all the guests, and for all the lovely messages. It's been a different kind of remembrance this year, but we've shown how we can still continue to remember the fallen and honour our armed forces. It's great to do something together, even though separately, but ours is an association founded on that strong sense of community. And during this period of remembrance and the pandemic, this fellowship is more important to us than ever. The Blesma Remembrance 11K event will still be running till the 15th of November. So good luck to everybody who didn't embark on their 11K today. Make sure you tag Blesma in all of your photos so we can follow your journey throughout the week. Thank you for joining us for the live stream today. Now, please join us in taking a 2-minute silence to remember the fallen and think on their sacrifice. a powerful moment. I think we can all agree it's so special to join in silence and know we are together, even in separation. Thank you to the wonderful supporters who joined us this morning, to all our guests, and for all the lovely messages. It's been a different kind of remembrance, but we have shown that we can still come together to remember the fallen and honour our armed forces. It's great to do something together as a community, especially in these times of isolation. Ours is an association founded on that strong sense of community. In this period of remembrance and during the pandemic, this fellowship is more important to us than ever. The Remembrance 11K will still be going on till the 15th of November. So good luck to everyone who did not complete their 11K today, but make sure you tag your Blesma in all of your photos so we can follow your journey throughout the week. Thank you for joining us on the live stream today. It's been my pleasure, and all your support today. Cheers.